But there's another sense in which this slogan is true, which is that all physical systems contain information. So I gave specific examples of this. Switch, open or close, contains information. The presence or the absence of a photon, a particle of light, contains information. Photon polarized like this or photon polarized like that contains information. But this discovery that all physical systems contain information is actually a very old discovery. If I have a physical system that has n bits, then that implies that it has 2 to the n, which I'll represent as being capital N, because capital N is bigger than little n. It has 2 to the n possible states. Conversely, if I have a system that has n states, then it can be used to represent log to the base 2 of n bits. So what is the logarithm? The logarithm is basically the total number of bits we need to represent this number. So for instance, if n is equal to 8, then log to the base 2 of 8 is equal to 3. It's the number of bits I need to write out 8, because 8 is equal to 1000. Well, actually, it's the number of zeros in the bits that I need to write it out. So when we have a system that has, you know, not just 2 states or 4 states or 8 states or 16 states or 1024 states, it still represents information. So for instance, if I have a system that has 3 states, for example, yes, no, and maybe, then it represents log to the base 2 of 3, which is equal to 2 plus change, 1 plus change bits. It's in between log to the base 2 of 2, which is equal to 1 bit, and log to the base 2 of 4, which is equal to 2 bits. So something that has 3 different states, it's not binary, it's ternary, then it has a number of bits in between 1 and 2. And this observation that any physical system that has a different number of distinguishable states can register a certain amount of information was actually realized back in the 19th century. So back in the 19th century, physicists such as Maxwell, James Clerk Maxwell, Ludwig Boltzmann in Vienna, Maxwell's at Cambridge, or Josiah Willard Gibbs at Yale, they realized that there was this funny quantity called entropy. Entropy. Now, what is entropy? Entropy is something that messes up your ability to do work. It's some measure of disorder. Or of randomness. The way that people came up with the concept of entropy in the middle of the 19th century was that they were looking at how energy could be converted to other forms of energy. So these scientists and others were interested in how heat could be transformed into work. And there's a famous result called the Second Law of Thermodynamics, and the Second Law of Thermodynamics basically says that, dynamics. I'll misspell a bunch of things in the course of these lectures, so alert people watching this can go and point them out. The Second Law of Thermodynamics says that entropy increases, or entropy tends to increase, let's say. But what is entropy? So back in the mid-19th century, these scientists realized that energy in heat was actually the kinetic energy, the microscopic energy of moving molecules. Molecules bouncing off of each other, they had a particular velocity, so they had a certain kind of kinetic energy, the energy of motion, and that we could identify the energy in heat with this energy of motion of all the individual molecules in a gas, like the gas in this room. Now, that's a certain amount of energy. They were able to measure this amount of energy, and they also were able to note that you could turn this energy into work using, for instance, a steam engine. You've got it here, you have a piston with a cylinder. Here's all these steam molecules bouncing all back and forth. You move out the piston, the molecules gradually slow down, their energy gets smaller, and that energy goes into work in the steam engine. But not all of this energy could be converted into work. Why is that? It's because these molecules bouncing off of each other, they have some degree of disorder. And this degree of disorder could not be decreased. So somehow, to have this degree of disorder, even when the piston goes out, they still have to be moving around. And so you can't extract all of the kinetic energy from these molecules. Now, because these guys, they were guys, by the way, in the course of these little lectures, I'm going to use the word guys to refer not only to people, men, but to also to elementary particles and to women as well. So these guys, they figured out that if they wanted to come up with a formula for entropy to describe this quantity that never decreased, they said, well, let's let n equal the number of possible states or configurations, or as Boltzmann very nicely put it, complexions of these molecules in the glass. And if they defined a quantity S which is equal to the logarithm of n, which you may note is the amount of information that's contained in these molecules in the gas just by counting the number of possible states, configurations, or complexions, if we want to call it that. This quantity right here, the log of n, is the number of bits that's required to label each of the possible different complexions or states of the molecules in the gas. And they said, if we define S to be proportional to this, they defined a constant K, which is now called Boltzmann's constant. If they defined this S to be K log N, then this was actually this quantity entropy, this thermodynamic quantity that gummed up the works of heat engines and prevented you from getting all the energy out of molecules. So famous, in fact, that it actually appears on Boltzmann's grave. He died in 1906 by his own hand. He was a depressive person after a visit to the United States. I'm not sure if there's any correlation between this. But back in those days, if you had a famous formula, people popped it on your grave. Actually, there's an interesting story, which is that this constant K that's on Boltzmann's grave was actually not defined by Boltzmann, but by the famous German physicist Max Planck. And it was originally called Planck's constant. But Planck also had another constant named after him, H, which we'll see again, because it governs the quantum mechanical behavior of things. So after a while, people just said, hey, let's just call it Boltzmann's constant. What Boltzmann would feel if he saw some other man's constant on his grave, I don't know. Maybe he'd be turning over in his grave.